Joining me on this, my friend Stephen Yates. You know Stephen. He's been on the program for years now. He is a strategist. He is a foreign policy expert, and he worked in the Bush administration. Stephen, happy Monday to you. Am I just looking at just the loudest military leaders who get into sort of the woke argument, or is there something to be said for why we seem to see more people in the upper echelon of the military talk about wokery and disinformation, and yet not really a lot of people discussing, except the head of U.S. Strategic Command, who said that, oh yeah, this is really greatly concerning, these missile silos in China. That's really the only mention that I've seen of this. Am I just looking in the wrong places, or is that not a priority?
No, unfortunately, it seems like our military brass, they have sort of a ruling class that thinks and speaks the same way the rest of the ruling class does in culture, media, finance, and politics. They seem to sip the same champagne, and they inhale the same helium, and they say the same basically crazy stuff. And what they really should be, I think you're exactly right, they shouldn't be focused so much about the boogeyman of disinformation. Their job is to give real information. And so how about giving some real information to educate the populace about conflicts that we need to prepare for, that we need to pay for, and that we need to watch out for? They could play a positive role, which is actually their job, and it would have the added benefit of probably giving them resources, motivated soldiers, and maybe some allies willing to come along. But this giant rabbit hole they've jumped down on disinformation is a distraction. It doesn't build anything up. It only tears us down. And I think it's a travesty. It's basically the biggest cancer of the early parts of the Biden administration.
It is. And it doesn't, I don't think it really, it inspires a lot of confidence in our desire to maybe be aggressive in defending ourselves as our enemies are concerned. And this also, I mean, here we have now these high-level talks between another set of high-level talks between the United States and China. They were described as ending in a stalemate. Stephen, China apparently was upset. They accused the U.S. government of trying to, quote-unquote, contain and suppress China. And they said that we, here in the United States, this is communist Beijing, telling us that we are the, quote, inventor of coercive diplomacy, and that China is just Americans' imagined enemy. So it doesn't sound like the talks went well.
No, it's kind of remarkable that we had Secretary Blinken go with a counterpart and get sort of wrapped around like a rag doll in a dog's mouth by the Chinese interlocutors. And Deputy Secretary Sherman goes to China and they downgrade her counterpart, and they essentially give her some homework and pat her on the head. In normal modern parlance, that would be considered sexist, arrogant, and a whole bunch of other stuff. But apparently, woke world is completely distracted with other stuff. But really, this is just remarkable. We have done a terrible job of containing and holding China back. If that has been our objective, we've done an awful job of that. And if they were really concerned about it, they would want us to continue to do an awful job. But the weird thing about right now is China is actually saying the quiet part out loud. They're showing their fangs. They're giving all of the grist anyone should need to wake up and say, oh, no, this is a problem that we need to build coalitions to resist. And it's probably going to cost us money. It might cost us opportunity. But they're taking the choice away from us. But the Biden diplomats have just been smacked around brutally in two rounds of talks so far, which is probably why the people around the president haven't exactly set up that big summit with Xi Jinping.
That's what I was getting ready to go to, because if these are just the kind of, Blinken, an underling of the president of the United States, and they're going this badly, I can't imagine that there would actually be any kind of move towards sitting Joe Biden down across from Xi Jinping.
Well, as we have seen, he is only capable of reading whatever is on his note card and calling on the person he has been told to call upon. Otherwise, he is going to get in trouble. Mm-hmm. And so if he is sitting in front of the leader of China, who literally has no problem killing people and taking away basic rights and launching whatever kind of campaigns, he doesn't have to refer to note cards. He can kind of memorize what he wants to say for an hour-long meeting. In a way, the Chinese would almost be smart to go ahead and take that meeting, because there's a big go signal that they could have their way. Plus, right by the president's side is the former Secretary of State, our czar of all things important, the climate. Mm. And so he's ready to make the deal of the millennium that could put all of these other issues as subordinate in order to try to seek that deal. So I'm frankly grateful the Chinese haven't pushed for it. But hopefully the Americans see what's happening. My greatest frustration, which is never going to be completely resolved, is most people don't pay attention to what's going on in these kinds of talks. And why would they? They're dead boring. Mm. But it's an important strategic signal.
Yeah.
It's coming from a rising adversary. So hope they tune in.
Yeah, and I agree with you. I feels almost that, because I know Russia's a concern, and I was going to ask you a question about Nord Stream, but I think that if something, for the lack of a better way to put it, would pop off, it'd be with China over Taiwan and something out in the Pacific first, which we are less prepared in that region than we are in dealing with something like Russia, which, of course, you know, you have NATO, even though Germany would be compromised. But with China, I mean, would we even, if something like that were to happen in the United States in order to protect its interests or to even stop them, that aggression from coming across the Pacific and coming here to the United States, who knows? They have 120 missile silos. They've been really trying to work. They've been working very hard at developing such capabilities. I don't know what, I mean, the war games that so far have been reported on, Stephen, we haven't come out too successful. And I don't know who else would stand with us in such an instance.
Well, we've done very little to prepare. I do think that the previous administration, with Secretary Pompeo and some others working allies around the world, did reorient the way people were thinking about this challenge. And we did have a focus on technology and what China was doing through its political warfare in the United States Senate and some of its counterparts. There's a common understanding that these Confucius Institutes are basically not your friendly neighborhood, let's eat Chinese food and learn how to speak Chinese kind of places, that they're actually stealing things from you that might be of value, including your job and your security. And so I think part of the world has wised up a bit, but all of the focus really should be on China as the top priority. It's a hard challenge under the best of circumstances, with the brightest leadership, with the greatest amount of support, and we know we don't have that right now. So it's even more of a challenge. Russia pales in comparison as a strategic challenge or a threat. And we still have the threat of radicalism that could come out of the broader Middle East with an emboldened Iran. And that also would be a greater direct threat to the security of Americans, American allies, and American homeland than anything coming from Russia is. Mm. And so the Russia, Russia, Russia sort of punch-drunk campaign from the last 5 years, that really has to stop. These other things are big, and they're nipping at us now. And I think they feel like they're winning.
Yeah, oh, I feel that way, too. We're talking with Stephen Yates, a foreign policy expert. You can find him on Twitter at YatesComms. I really feel like if Russia wanted to have taken over Ukraine, which is what they would love to do, they would have done it. If they would have had the means to do so, and if they felt that, you know, they wouldn't get enough pushback, even during this administration, they would, which is always why I'm like, yeah, it's a concern. It's on, you know, it's on the stovetop, but it's towards the back. You know, I feel like what's happening with China and the cyber hacking, the development of missiles, and then of course, you know, we talked about this last week, their bizarro video that they put out where they were talking about nuking Japan. I mean, they didn't go to anything else. It was straight to nukes. Not a single response from the administration, which I think that would at least bring something out. I don't know what they stand to benefit by not acknowledging it, because we all saw it.
No, that is, it's disheartening and concerning. And that's, of course, after unleashing a great bioweapon on the world, whether it was intentional or accidental, knocking some GDP points off of every major power and putting people into a full-blown panic out into the world. I mean, really, they couldn't have come up with a better way to scare people into staying to their homes and cutting back on interaction. I see our footing right now as not very good at deterring anyone. And we send the weakest representatives out to the world. And we've talked for over a decade about a concept that I think is common sense, but needs to be more widely held. Weakness is provocative. If we are strong at home with our determination, with our messaging, we don't actually increase the chances of conflict, war, and loss. It's the weakness that is provocative. That's what invites another 9/11. It's what invites some kind of a crisis in the Taiwan Straits. If the bad guys see that we are strong and we are resolved and we have partners, then they say, I'll just live to fight another day. I'll wait it out. I'll wait for the next bozo to come around through this crazy Democratic cycle, because they just sit back and they've got life, permanent life employment.
Right.
But, what, you know, the strength preserves peace and the weakness is provocative. And right now, we're sending out a big provocative signal.
A big provocative signal, for sure. Last question for you, and I know that this is probably way in depth, and we may have to continue the conversation on this one next week or later. We're talking to our friend Stephen Yates. I was having a conversation with my oldest son, who is, he's studying, one of his, he's taken a summer class that has to do with foreign policy for his major. And we were having a conversation about why it was that, because Britain, for, you know, all intents and purposes, handled administration for the most part for Hong Kong before basically giving that back or giving it to Beijing. And I was thinking about this and wondering, well, what position would we be in had Britain never done that?
Mm-hmm. That's true. It was kind of the beginning of a pretty big unraveling. In a way, it was part of a piece where strategic decisions were made in the 1960s and 70s. And people will vigorously argue against my point of view on this because it's informed by what happened after. Mm-hmm. But we made a decision that the Soviet Union was a bigger and longer term strategic threat to the United States, and that the interests of that were presented by China were a lesser threat. What we didn't factor in was how good the eggheads of the Western world would be in making China richer and more powerful over time. And so the strategic decision to minimize the threat of China, engage them, and to try to battle against the Soviets was the beginning of this provocative weakness. Following that, Britain had the island of Hong Kong and the territory direct across from it, but all of the water that they needed to rely upon would come from territories that were not ceded in perpetuity to them. And so Deng Xiaoping and the government of China, clever as they are, knew that they had them where they wanted them and could impose that will. It was far from an ideal circumstance to negotiate, but had the West stayed strong in the Cold War, not conceded so much to China, very likely we would have been on a dramatically different trajectory with Hong Kong, but also just the general state of potential freedom in China.
Wow. Oh, wow. I mean, it's just devastating. And you look, oh, yeah, it's, I tell you, Stephen Yates. Well, now we're going to start our week. Now I'll be in depressed and just, it's okay. We're going to talk about like kittens and sunshine and puppies and, you know, all kinds of good stuff when I talk with you next week. Stephen, always a pleasure. Your insight's valuable. There's nobody better. Appreciate you. Thank you.
Thank you, Dana. Take care.
Of course. You too.